Everybody scattered to their seats.
Okay.
Alan was holding everybody up. I'm Greg. I'm the youth pastor here. If y'all haven't met me before, if you have, then you already know me. But there's welcome cards back there in the foyer.
No, they're behind. On the backs of the seats now.
Backs of the seats. They keep changing everything. Y'all seen them though, didn't you? All right, but if you're new to here, just fill one of those things out, and you can take it to the back. They'll give you a present. It's nice, they say. They haven't given me one.
I got one.
Is it? Well, they probably thought you was a visitor. All right, let's move on. Last week we talked about James, right? Having an effective prayer life and how important that is. It is. It's very true to have an effective prayer life. And fitting for December, we're going into searching for Christmas. You know, I think everybody, there's a lot of people out there that's searching for their own Christmas. And there's a lot of people out there that, you know, their Christmas ain't the right Christmas. And we need to do our part and make sure that everybody understands that Christmas is something that happens every day of the year. Jesus Christ, he died on the cross and gave us a present that, you know, we didn't deserve. And hopefully that we get the opportunity to find Christmas, and others do as well. But let's pray, and then we'll stand to sing. So if y'all want to, let's stand, and we'll stand and pray, and y'all just stay there, and we'll just start singing. Okay? Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for allowing us to be here on this beautiful day. Thank you for blessing us with a Savior. Thank you for giving us an opportunity to just lay our baggage at your feet. Lord, if someone here hasn't taken that opportunity, let this word today resonate in their heart and let them just have a closer relationship with you. Lord, be with the preacher today as he brings the word. Be with the praise band as they worship you in song. Lord, just give us the heart for you. And I thank you for what you're going to do in this church today. We say this in your name. Amen.
Amen.
Joy on earth. Good morning and welcome to Cedarwood Church. We are so thankful that you chose to worship with us. Here are just a few things that you need to know. On Saturday, December 12th, our kids are encouraged to drop by the church between 10 and 11 to receive their Christmas gift. Also, on Saturday, December 12th, the youth are going ziplining. Meet at the church at 2 o'clock and the youth Christmas party will follow. On Sunday, December 13th at 5 o'clock, we're having our Christmas Night of Praise. Be sure to see Christine to sign up. That's everything you need to know for this week. We hope you have a fantastic week. Thank you again for choosing to worship with us.
Y'all excited about Christmas coming?
Yeah.
Kind of need a good Christmas after this year, don't we?
Yeah.
Woo. Let's stand and continue worshiping together this morning.
Hey. A baby changes everything. was lost, but now I am found. A baby changes everything. A baby changes everything.
Christina, isn't that song true? If it wasn't for that baby, we wouldn't be here right now, right? Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for sending that baby into the world to change not only our futures, but every single person that's ever walked this planet, Father. We thank you for that. As we start the Christmas season and we start a series of messages talking about it, Father, be with us and help us to find and discover the true meaning of Christmas. Help us not to get caught up in the hustle and bustle that the world says is Christmas, but help us to focus on what you say is important. So be with us during this series, and be with us today as we ask in your precious Son, Jesus' name. How many of you have ever had one of those days that everything was going wrong and you just wished that you never had gotten out of bed? Ever had one of those days?
Hey,
how many of you feel like 2020 is a year just strung together, those kind of days? Can we all agree that 2020, it's been a tough year, hasn't it? But you know what? It started out for me. I was excited about 2020 when it started out. I mean, we hired Christine, brought her on full time. She was part time, brought her on full time, gave her some new positions. Everybody on our leadership team was saying that this was going to be our breakout year as a church. We had grown every year since I had been at the church. And y'all remember, this place was packed. There was only a few empty seats. We had architects making drawings to expand our worship center because we needed to do something. And all of these things were going on. I got to go to Israel. A lifelong dream, and actually walked in some of the places that Jesus walked. And then all of a sudden, about March, we got hit by COVID-19. Changed a lot of things, didn't it? And from March to May, we had to close the doors of our church. Our staff, we would get together on Thursday, and we would record the service. There was only four of us in here. I'm preaching basically to empty chairs. Christine and I were singing to empty chairs. And all of a sudden we got to come back. And only about 50% of our church came back. We still got over 100 people that have not been back to church since COVID started. As a pastor, it's been tough because you can't go to the hospital to visit someone when they're sick. We've had several of our church members that passed away during this, and we couldn't do a service for them right away. We had to cancel Good News Club at the elementary school. We had to stop our Bible study at Lander University, Trail Life, CR. All of the programs that we did got stopped. They got canceled. And this was supposed to be our breakout year. Then it was an election year. Those are always fun, right? That always causes some problems that we always see every election year. And then personally, Kathy had 5 bypasses in March. And 2 of them didn't work, and she had to go get stents after that. And then she had melanoma on her leg. And the doctor said, what should I do about it? He says, you have 2 choices. You either leave it alone and die, or you get it removed. That was your choices. Madison had some health issues, which caused her to pass out, have a wreck. My youngest daughter, 24, had cognitive issues. And luckily, we got that worked out. But hey, I saved a bunch on my auto insurance. If it's been a rough year for you, or your plans didn't turn out the way you thought, would you raise your hand this year? See, look at that. Look at all the hands going up. This has been a tough year. This has been a rough year. Things are not turning out the way we had planned. And if that's you, I'm going to tell you, you're in the right place today. We're starting a brand new series called Searching for Christmas. And on your outline, there's something, a statement I want to make that I want you to have in your mind. One of the things that the Christmas story teaches is that God can change our plans. Now, I want you to think about that. Everyone involved in the Christmas story, their plans got changed. Nobody's plans turned out the way they thought they would. You think Mary and Joseph's plans got changed? Here's a young couple. They were in love. All they wanted to do was to start a home, to get a house, to have children, to get married, and to live a life of peace and quiet. And then this angel comes along and says, no, God's got a different plan for you. Now, I don't want you to get upset, but you're going to get pregnant. And it's going to be before the wedding, and Joseph ain't going to be the daddy. It's going to be a miracle. It's going to be a virgin birth. And good luck telling your parents about it. Oh, and by the way, that baby that you're going to be carrying, that's going to be God's son. Do you think God messed up Mary and Joseph's plans? God messed up King Herod's plans. The Roman Empire had named him King of Judea, which means he was King of the Jews. And the thing about Herod, Herod wasn't even Jewish. So can you imagine when the Magi came to his palace and said, hey, where is this King of the Jews born? And he goes, we're looking for the King of the Jews. I'm the King of the Jews. And the problem about Herod was paranoid. He was always afraid somebody was going to overthrow his kingship. Matter of fact, he had his wife killed. He had his mother killed. He had his brother-in-law killed. He had two of his sons killed because he was afraid they would try to take over his power. And when he heard that the King of the Jews had been born in Bethlehem, remember what he did? He went berserk. And he sent soldiers into Bethlehem to kill every single boy that was under the age of two. How do you think the Jews felt about him then, after that happened? God messed up Herod's plans. God messed up the religious leaders' plans. They had been praying for a Messiah, for a Savior, for a long, long time. But they were praying for a military Savior. They were praying for a political Savior. They were praying for a warrior. They were praying for somebody to come in and overthrow the Roman Empire. And what do you think they were thinking when Jesus came on the scene and he's saying things like, love your enemy. If somebody slaps you on the right cheek, turn the other cheek. Love your neighbor as yourself. Do good those that despise you. Return good for evil. And they're going, huh? What? This isn't the coming of Messiah we wanted. We don't need a spiritual Messiah. We need a political Messiah. So God messed up their plans. God messed up the innkeeper's plans. Roman Empire called for a census in the land. And so everybody had to go to their hometown to be counted in the census. And he certainly hadn't planned for all those extra crowds, right? That's why Mary and Joseph had to stay at a stable because he didn't have room for them in the inn. He hadn't planned. And maybe if he'd had time, maybe he could have added on to the inn. God messed up the innkeeper's plans. God messed up the shepherd's plans. Here they were. They were out abiding in the field. Just wanting another quiet night. Just another night where they could just take it easy under the stars. And then all of a sudden an angel and an angel's choir came in these glorious lights. And they said, you guys better get over to Bethlehem. Savior of the world is about to be born. And God messed up their plans. Has God ever messed up your plans? How many of your plans got messed up for 2020? So God messes up our plans. Maybe you planned a vacation and then COVID closed everything down. You couldn't go on your vacation. How many of y'all fit into that category? Or maybe you were planning on moving to a different state and the new job fell through. Maybe you planned to be a teacher in a Sunday school class and all of a sudden the church shut down. That happened to us, didn't it? Maybe you were planning on getting married and then you find out your fiancé cheated on you. Or maybe you were planning on going to college, and then all of a sudden you realize your family needs you to go to work to not go to college. Maybe you were going to be a professional athlete, and in the last game of your senior year, you break your back. Which happened to a good coach of mine that was my golf coach and football coach when I was in middle school. Coach Bland was the number one rated quarterback of the whole state of Texas. He had scholarship offers from every single major college in the state. They were all looking at him. He was trying to decide where he was going to go. And on the very last play of his last game as a senior, he got hit and broke his back. And his plans were changed. He became a high school football coach, or middle school football coach after that. All of us make plans only to see them change. Proverbs 19:21 says this, you can make many plans. And we do, don't we? You can make many plans, but the Lord's purpose will prevail. So you may have some great plans for 2021, but sometimes God is going to change your plan. And that's what we're going to talk about today. Three things that we can learn from the Christmas story when God changes our plans. And the first thing that I want you to know, when God changes your plans, He's trying to get your attention. How many of you heard the saying, God whispers to us in our pleasure, but He shouts to us in our pain? How many of you ever heard that? See, pain is God's megaphone. It's God's way of getting our attention, of saying, are you listening? Are you paying attention? Are you too busy to talk to me? Think about God's plan for Mary and Joseph. This is an amazing plan. This is an awesome plan. Isn't it an honor to be the parents of God's Son? But did that plan bring any problems? How's Mary going to tell her parents? How's Mary going to tell Joseph? How's Mary going to tell the rest of the people in the village? She could have been stoned. She could have been ostracized. She could have been ridiculed. Can you imagine every time she's walking down the streets of the village, people go, there's that crazy pregnant girl that told her parents that she's still a virgin. Can you imagine that? See, God had to do some extraordinary things in their case to convince them of what was going to happen. He sent an angel, and He doesn't normally do that. And the angel came and says, look, this is what's going to happen. And it's never happened before. And I don't know about you, but God's never sent an angel to me. Has He ever sent an angel to you to have a conversation? I don't think He's ever sent one to me, because I think if I saw an angel, I'd probably wet my pants, right? So would you. So how do we hear what God is saying to us? Folks, we have to listen. We have to listen. And here's our problem. We're not very good at listening, are we? Instead, what do we like to do? We like to do a lot of talking, don't we, Greg? We like to do a lot of talking, or we're listening to the wrong thing. So we're so busy, God can't get through to us. I've had many people over the years come to me and tell me, says, you know what, Pastor? God has never spoken to me. God has never spoken to me. Folks, if that's you, you know why God has never spoken to you? It's not that He's not speaking to you. You're not listening to Him. Does God ever call you and get a business signal? See, our society, we've gotten too busy for God. We're too busy working. We're too busy watching TV. We're too busy on social media. We're too busy being on our phone. We're too busy rushing from here to there. We're too busy socializing. And folks, until we get alone with God and say, hey, God, is there anything that you need to tell me? God can't get through because we're too busy. Psalm 81:13. Don't not miss this verse. God says, I wish my people would listen to me. God said, I wish my people would listen to me. Folks, isn't it amazing that after 4,000 years, people still don't listen to God? It's like we all got spiritual ADD, isn't it? So why does God want us to listen to Him? He wants to save us from some of our problems. He wants to save us from some of our problems. Have you ever discovered when you listen to you, things don't go that well? But when you listen to God, things fall into place. You ever notice that? And so here's what God's saying. He said, listen to me. I'll give you some perspective that you do not have. Proverbs 16:25 says this, there is a path before each person that seems right, but it ends in death. And here's what Solomon said. We all make a lot of bad decisions. Ever made a bad decision? Have you ever made a decision you thought was right? You know what? I'm going to marry this person. I'm going to take this job. I'm going to go into this relationship. I'm going to start this business. I'm going to buy this house. And then things turn out wrong. You ever been there? When we find ourselves in that situation, you know what happened? We don't listen to God. Before you married that person, did you pray about it? Did you ask God, is this the right person? Before you started that bit, did you say, is this what I need to do? See, that's why we make decisions that end up in disaster. Because here it is. We have a limited perspective, don't we? We don't know the future. We don't know the future, and we can't see the big picture that God sees. But here's the thing. God knows everything. God has no limits. Did you know that God knows about every situation that's going on in your life? He knows everything about you. Have you ever gone up into the mountains and get on one of those curvy mountain roads? And all of a sudden you get behind a slow car? That ever happened? And what do you want to do? You want to pass that car because it is holding you up, but you can't see around the curve. So what are your choices? You can either pass and risk your life and everybody in the car's life, or you can just stay there behind that slow person. Right? Now, when you're driving on that curvy road and you're behind that slow person, don't you wish that you had a friend up in a helicopter above you? Going, you know what? It's okay. No cars for 2 miles. It's all right to pass. Wouldn't you like to have that? And here's the thing. Your friend has a perspective that you do not have, right? And they can tell you when it's safe. They know when it's safe and when it isn't to pass. And see, the Bible sometimes tells us some things we should do, and it tells us some things that we shouldn't do, and we think we know better than God. Well, God, I know what makes me happier better than you do, so what do? We ignore God, and we do our own thing. I'm going to pass that car anyway. Don't miss this. Everything God does in your life is for your own good. Everything God does in your life is for your own good because He loves you. He wants to protect you. He cares about you. He doesn't want you to have a broken heart. He doesn't want you to have a broken marriage. He doesn't want you to have a broken relationship. He doesn't want you to have broken dreams. He doesn't want you to get run over by an 18-wheel truck while passing. And God's saying, will you just listen to me? Because I have a little perspective that you do not have. So the first thing, when God changes our plans, He's trying to get our attention. The second thing is, it means that He has a better plan for you. Whose plan do you think is better? Yours or God's? Jeremiah 29:11. I'm going to read you out of a different translation that you probably haven't heard that much of. I know what I'm planning for you, says the Lord. I have good plans. What kind of plans? Good plans. For you, not plans to hurt you, and I will give you hope and a good future. As we go into 2021, does anyone in here know what's going to happen? Does anybody in here know what's going to happen in 2021? But God's Word says, I have good plans for you. I got good plans for you. But God is not going to force His plans on you. He gives us a choice, and we get a choice to choose. Are we going to follow our little plan over here? Or are we going to follow God's plan over here? We have to make that decision. And I'm going to give you three things about God's plan. God's plan is always bigger and better than your plan. Mary and Joseph wanted to get married, have babies, and settle down. That was their plan. But just think about it. If they had done that plan, no one would have ever known their name. They would have never made an impact on the world, and they would have just lived their life, and they would have died, and we'd never know who they were, right? They'd have done their plan. But here's the thing. But God's plan for them blessed the entire world. It made it possible for every man, woman, boy, and girl to come to salvation and experience eternal life with God. It was bigger than they ever imagined. And God's plan for each and every one of you is bigger than you can ever imagine. So you can do your plan, but you will always be limited in what you do. Second thing is, God's plan is always more rewarding. I spent most of my life following my own plan. Successful salesperson, nice house, nice car, provided for my family. But there was always something missing. There was always something missing. And as I experienced, I was never happy. I was not impacting people around me. And then September 11th happened. Y'all remember September 11th, right? I had been heading to Atlanta when we found out it happened with some of my salespeople, but I got back that afternoon and I was sitting in my office. We didn't know what was going on, all the details. And a customer of mine called and said, I need to order 2 toner cartridges. And I'm thinking, we've just had 2 terrorist attacks. And my life was so important, somebody's calling to order 2 toner cartridges for their printer. And I'm going, am I making any difference in the world? That's the importance of me. 1 Corinthians 2:9 says this, no one has ever seen, heard, or even imagined what wonderful things God has ready for those who love Him. Do you realize that God's got big plans for you if you follow His? Do you realize that? And then the third thing about God's plan, sometimes God's plan is harder. I'm not going to lie to you. Sometimes God's plan to follow is harder. Think about the Apostle Paul and all the things that he went through. Anybody of y'all want to trade places with Paul's life? What about Elijah? I mean, Elijah's got so bad, he just prayed, God, kill me. Just take my life. Or Silas just followed along with Paul. Then all of a sudden he finds himself being beaten and thrown into a Roman prison in Philippi. About Peter and all the disciples. You ever read about their deaths? They died some horrible deaths, all except for John, but they tried to boil John alive. Don't you think it would have been a whole lot easier for Peter, Andrew, and James and John if they had just remained fishermen? Wouldn't their life have been a whole lot easier? But let me tell you, what every single one of them had in common. Because they followed God's plan, they changed the world. Amen. They changed the world. Sometimes God's plan can be confusing, can't it? You ever been there? Do you think Mary ever felt confused when her neighbors were making fun of her? Do you think she was confused when she had to go tell her parents and go tell Joseph? Like, God, why am I having to do this? I didn't do anything wrong. You don't think maybe she was confused? Sometimes it's painful. What was Mary doing the day before she delivered? She was riding on a donkey, heading to Bethlehem. You think that was uncomfortable for a woman in her condition? Some of you ladies, y'all been there. Would you want to ride a donkey? Don't you think it was uncomfortable for her to deliver that baby in a stable with only animals around? Don't you think she would have much rather been back at home with her mother and her aunts there helping her to deliver? See, God's plan, it was difficult. And I'm sure there are times when Mary's going, why, God? Why, God? And you know what? Sometimes in our life, we're going to ask that same question. Why, God? Why, God, why is this happening to me? But I love what Jesus says in John 13:7. He says, you don't understand now what I'm doing, but you will understand later. Mary understood later, didn't she? So when your plans are changed by God, first thing is He's trying to get your attention. The second thing is He's got a better plan. The third thing is He wants you to learn to trust Him. I want you to kind of imagine what this whole Christmas thing was for Joseph. His fiancée comes up to him and says, "Honey, I'm pregnant, and you know you're not the father." If your fiancée told you that, what would you be thinking? What would you want to do? And then an angel came and said, "You know what? I want you to marry her anyway." God was testing his faith. And you know what? This plan was so radically different that all they could do was trust God. You ever heard this saying? Sometimes you don't know God is all you need until God is all you got. And in that moment, we learn to trust God. Jeremiah 29:13 says, "You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart." A couple examples from our own church. Chris Raines. Do you think Chris Raines' plan was to lose his leg in a car accident? Do you think that was his plan? "God, that's the plan I want. I want to lose my leg." Well, I knew Chris very, very, very well. And I knew at that time before that happened, Chris was searching for something. He really didn't know his purpose in life. He was just kind of floundering in life, just going through the motions. And then all of a sudden, after he lost his leg, God gave him a purpose. Matter of fact, I saw on Facebook just last night where he was talking about, "You know what, because of what happened to me, I brought two young men that were 24 years old together, both suffered brain injuries in a car accident together last night. And it encouraged them." And he's doing that all the time. Because God changed his plans, Chris now has a purpose. Kelly Birmingham, do you think it was her plan to get breast cancer? Do you think that was her plan? Have you seen any of the posts that she has put on Facebook, or have you talked to her? What a positive attitude that she has had. And you can just tell that God is using this cancer to grow her faith. But it's also is seeing other people make an impact on her life, and she's making an impact on other people's life. Sometimes God changes our plan so that we can learn to trust Him. You know what? You trust that He knows what He's doing. You trust that He is wise, that He cares about you, that He's going to help you get through that situation. Romans 8:28 says, "We know," and I want you to underline, "We know. We know that all that happens to us is working for our good if we love God and are fitting into His plans." Well, what do we know? We aren't guessing. We know for certain, we are confident of what? That you know what? Nothing that happens to you or I takes God by surprise. So when you lose that job, or you have a financial difficulty, or your child rebels, or you get sick, God ain't up in heaven going, "Oh, I didn't see that one coming." Folks, everything that happens in your life is not good. Did you know that? There are bad things that happen to us. Can we get an amen on that? Some we bring on ourselves, don't we? Some other people bring into our lives, but they're not God's fault. God didn't bring them. But God can cause everything to work for the good. He can take something bad and He can make it good. There was an African king, and he had a close friend that went with him everywhere he went. And one day they were out hunting, and his friend's job was to prepare the weapons. And so as they were out hunting, he handed the king a gun, and evidently he had done something wrong in loading the gun. And when the king shot it, it blew his thumb off. Now this friend of his was always very positive. And anything that happened, whether good or bad, he always said, "This is good." And so when the king shot it, his thumb blew off, he goes, "This is good." And the king's going, "No, it's not." And he was so mad, he threw his friend in prison. And so about a year later, he was out hunting, and he was in a place that he shouldn't have been because there were cannibals in this area. And he was out there, and he got captured by these cannibals, and they took him, they tied him up, they put him on a stake, they put wood underneath him, and they were going to cook him. But as they were about to light the fire, they noticed that he didn't have one of his thumbs. And they were very superstitious, and they wouldn't eat anybody unless they were home. So they let him go. And so he was heading back home, and he was like, man, and I put my friend in prison, and he's been in there for a year. And so he decided, I'm going to go see my friend. So he went to see his friend in prison, and he goes, you know what? I'm so sorry for what I did to you. You were right. It was good that I lost my thumb. But it was not good that I put you in prison. His friend goes, yeah, yeah, it was. It was good that you put me in prison. He goes, well, how can you say that? How can you say it was good for you to be in prison for a year? He goes, if I wasn't in jail, I'd have been with you. God can take things that are bad that he can make them good. You get that? God can take that bad thing in your life and he can make it good. So when your plans get changed, you need to understand that God has given you a test. He's testing you to see, are you going to trust him or are you going to trust yourself? Who are you going to trust? You know what? We don't know what 2021 holds. We don't know. None of us do. Nobody knows what the future holds. Could anybody have predicted what would have happened in 2020? But here's what we do know. God has a plan and purpose for your life. You believe that? God has a plan and purpose for your life. And sometimes God changes your plans. God gives us a free will, and we can decide what to do. We can choose to go in our direction, we can choose to follow God's will for our lives. Let me give you three quick warning signs that you're not following God's plan. One is fatigue. You know what? If you're experiencing fatigue, you're not following God's plan. Second one is frustration. If you're experiencing frustration, you're not following God's plan. And the third one is fear. If you're experiencing fear and worry and anxiety, you're not following God's plan. So are you experiencing fatigue or frustration or fear? Psalm 138 says, the Lord will work out his plans for my life, for his faithful love endures forever, and he made me. God has a plan for your life, and he made you for a reason, and he sent his son into the world to be our Savior. Do you hear what I said? He sent his son into the world to be our Savior. And it is God's plan that every single one of us accept him as our Lord and Savior. And the angels announced on that first Christmas, they said, today a Savior has been born, and get this, for you. For who? For you. He is Christ the Lord. So why do we celebrate Christmas? Because God sent his son into the world to be our Savior. And you're saying, I don't need a Savior. I'm not grounded. Well, I don't care if you believe that you need a Savior or not. You need a Savior. You need a Savior. You need a Savior to save you from yourself. You need a Savior to give you a purpose. You need a Savior to save you for eternity. You need a Savior to forgive you of your sins. And you need a Savior to help you figure out the path, the right path. And God said, I'm sending my son to the world because you need a Savior. And it's God's gift to the world. John 3:16 says, and God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. Whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have what? Jesus' gift is his son, Jesus Christ, because we need a Savior. Have you ever accepted God's gift of his son? Let me look at it this way. Let's say that you give me a Christmas gift. And I take the Christmas gift, it's all wrapped and beautiful, and I put it under my tree. And And then about March or April comes and you go, "Hey, Clint, did you like the Christmas gift I got you?" And I go, "Well, I'm sure it was a great gift. I'm sure I would have enjoyed it, but I didn't open it." And you'd be going, "What? You didn't open it? I mean, I gave you a gift and you didn't open it." And I'd be going, "Oh, I meant to, but I just got too busy." How would you feel if you gave me a gift and I didn't even open it? How would you feel? Yet millions of people every year celebrate Christmas and they've never opened a gift. First year I was here at Christmas time, I preached a sermon. And four people over the age of 70 got saved. Never forget that. And after the service, one of those men came up to me and he said, "I have been coming to church for 50 years. For 50 years. He said, "I never got it till today." He said, "I finally given my life to Christ." And that may be you. You may have been putting up Christmas decorations every year. You might have been celebrating Christmas your whole life, but you have never opened up the gift. God wants to save you. That's part of His plan. Let me give you a nugget to take home. I want you to remember this. God wants you to open His gift of salvation this Christmas. And He's been changing your plan so He can get your attention. He's been changing your plans because He's got a better plan for you. He's been changing your plans so that you will learn to trust Him. So, is God trying to get your attention this morning? Is He trying to get your attention? And are you going to open His gift? Would you bow your head? Would you close your eyes? Dear Heavenly Father, as we come to this time of invitation, every one of us has experienced a very tough year. There's been a lot happening in our city and in our state and in our country and in the world. Things that are beyond our control. And it's been tough. And there have been some days that we just assumed, wish we'd have just stayed in bed. And you changed our plans, just like you changed all the players first Christmas plans. And you're trying to get some people in here's attention this morning. And they're not listening. God, I pray today that all ears are listening as you call them to receive your Son, to open the gift you've given us. And you tell people, "Hey, look, I'm changing your plans because I got a better plan. Is your life going the direction you want it to go? Is it going somewhere south? You're not going the direction God wants. Maybe that's you. Maybe you need to turn to God. Maybe you were a Christian and you just turned away. Maybe today's the day that you need to rededicate. You need to come back to Him." Some of you, you're following your own plans because you just don't trust God. You just don't trust Him. Jesus is saying today, "Would you trust me? Would you put your faith and your trust in me to save you?" So, Father, I just pray as we come this time of invitation, that if there's anybody here today that does not know who you are, that they do not walk out of this building without accepting you as their Lord and Savior. And I just pray, Father, that there's some people here that have gotten away from you and they're doing their own plan, that they come back today. And they begin to follow your plan for them. That they rededicate their life and they head in the right direction. I just lift up all of these folks to you this morning. We pray this precious prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Baby, tell
Tommy, would you come and close us out in prayer? But before he does, I want to make a couple announcements. We're going to be called into a business meeting right after Tommy prays. And we're going to do two things. We're going to vote on the budget. Again, we had discussion Wednesday night. That's when we took questions. So we're just voting on the budget, yes or no. No questions. And we'll also be voting on deacons. We nominated them last week. There are five on the ballot. You will circle two. If you circle three, then we don't know which two you really want. So just circle two. It's all right. Just vote for one if you want to do that. But two is who we're voting for. We'll have two new deacons come on. So very, very simple. Shouldn't take more than about 5 minutes. So if you're visiting with us, you can stay in our business meeting if you want. Not going to last very long. Or you can dismiss and you can head out the back door. That's your choice. But Tommy, can you close this out?
Father, we're so thankful for everything you do for us. We're thankful for your love. We're thankful for your son, Jesus. Oh, we're so thankful for the church and the people. We love you so much, Lord. I'm just so thankful, Lord. Lord, thank you for the blessings that you put on this church. Thank you for all that you're doing here. Lord, we just want to bless your holy name and lift you up. In Jesus' name, amen.